Okay, so just to remind you what we are discussing, we are talking about control hazard. And last time we saw in a typical five-stage pipe, so this is what happens, right? You fetch a branch instruction here and you get to know the target at this point. So essentially you have a two instruction delay before you know the target, but MIPS has a phased execution where they make sure that the branch target is ready in the positive half of the cycle so that the fetcher can fetch in the negative half of the cycle. So that's how they nullify one of the bubbles. But they still have one bubble left, and they rely on the compiler to fill up this particular instruction. So this is called a branch delay slot. And if compiler can fill up something, we discussed last time, from where you can pick up an instruction to fill the slot. That will not be a wasted cycle. Otherwise, it will probably fill up with a NOA, which is essentially a bubble. All right. And is this clear to everybody? Any question on this? Okay, and then we also discussed something called the branch target buffer, where essentially the idea is that in the fetch stage, you look up a particular cache. So that's the branch target buffer. It's a cache holding your branch targets. So you look it up in the fetch stage, and the BTB gives you a target, which you can use in the next cycle to fetch. So essentially what that means is, I look up my BTB right here, and the problem was I didn't know what to fetch here, but now I can use the BTB's outcome to fetch an instruction here. Okay, all right. And if the BTB outcome is correct, then essentially I have nullified all the bubbles without relying on the compiler. So this slide summarizes nicely what a BTB does. So the BTB is looked up with the program counter of every instruction in parallel with fetching the instruction. So essentially, you have the program counter. You send the program counter to the memory for fetching the instruction. You send it to the BTB also for looking at it. All right, for every instruction. All right. On a BTB hit, it provides two pieces of information. What is that? The first one is that this instruction is a control transfer instruction, which is why it is hitting the BTB. All right. And the second thing is the target of this control transfer instruction seen last time. Okay, so the BTB always stores the last target that this control transfer instruction went to. All right. So this target will be used to fetch in the next cycle. All right. On the other hand, if you miss the BTB, the fetcher really has no option but to fetch from the fall through path, which is PC plus one, in the next cycle. And a control transfer instruction is inserted in the BTB after the execution stage when its target is known. So you always insert the BTB when you know for sure where a particular control transfer instruction is going. You cannot insert anything wrong in the BTB. It has to be all the time correct. So essentially what you do is, once the branch is computed in the execution stage, you look up the BTB once more. And at this time, the instruction may hit in the BTB, because the BTB might have seen this branch already before. Okay. So now there are two options. If the branch is not taken in this particular execution, the BTB entry is invalidated. Why is that? Because we only want to store taken branches in BTB. Okay. Because remember that if you miss in the BTB, you anyway are going to take the fall through path. Okay. So it's better to save BTB space by not storing the not taken, the not taken branches. Otherwise, the entry is updated with the taken branch target. Okay, all right. If the lookup at this point misses in the BTB, it's cut out here actually, a new entry is allocated provided the branch is taken. So if the branch is not taken, then of course you don't allocate a new entry. Is this clear to everybody, this particular protocol? Okay, you look up the BTB at the fetch stage, you update the BTB after you have done executing the branch instruction. And of course you can optimize this part a little bit to save BTB bandwidth. You can say that, well, you can carry forward the BTB outcome with you. Because remember that a branch instruction must have looked up the BTB at the fetch stage already once. Okay. So you can carry forward its outcome to the execution stage and then match and decide whether to look up the BTP and insert anything or not. Okay. Any question on this? Is it clear?
Sir, so
yeah.
If there was a branch delay slot,
yeah,
and we also had a BTB,
yeah.
So still it's the compiler's responsibility to fill the branch delay.
Yes, slot. And the processor has to obey that. It has to execute that. In that case, BTB is of no use. Yeah, which is why MIPS R3000 did not have a BTB. Yeah. So I'm saying so BTB is going to be useful only when you say that, well, the compiler cannot fill up the delay slot. What else can I do there? How to save the power? So in many cases, your BTB will probably outperform a compiler filled in delay slot because it can see the dynamic behavior of a branch and can learn. Whereas the compiler sees the static piece of code and may not know what will happen at runtime. But of course, the penalty you pay here, we'll see gradually how it actually changes the pipeline hardware when you put a BTB. So there are extra pieces of hardware that you have to go here. And there is a danger of lengthening your cycle time also when you put a BTP. Okay. So let's take a simple example. Just evaluate the usefulness of the BTP. So let's assume that for a program, 90% of all control transfer instructions hit in the BTP. All right. 90% of outcomes provided by BTP hits are correct. 20% of control transfer instructions that miss in the BTP result in taken branches. Okay, so we want to know what fraction of bubbles are saved with these particular statistics. So what is that? So fraction of bubbles saved is same as BTP prediction accuracy. Okay, and which is, what is that? 0.9 fraction hit, and 0.9 of that are correct. All right. And your 10% of branches that miss, out of those, 20% are actually wrong, okay, right? Because these are taken branches. So 80% is correct. So 0.1 multiplied by 0.8 gives you 0.89. So we save 89% of bubbles with this, but we lose 11%. Okay, so 11% branches suffer from mispredictions and will require some recovery mechanism for correct execution. Because in 11% of these cases, what will happen is that we will take some BTP prediction and go along that path, but that's wrong, which you'll discover later. So you have to fix up something in the pipeline to make sure that the wrongly fetched instruction is removed from the pipeline. Is this example clear to you? Okay. All right. Okay. So this one we have already discussed, that the BTP will work great for loop branches. So essentially we say that you will mispredict the first time and the last time. Otherwise, it will be the same target all the time because the loop branch will always go back. But only last time it will actually fall through. And the first time there will be a missing BTP because you haven't seen the branch before. Alright? Subroutine calls, these are also great because they always go to the same place. So you call a subroutine from somewhere, it's always going to the subroutine target, right? And unconditional branches. So in these cases, your BTP will be highly accurate. Alright? So again, In this case, the first time you make a misprediction. And this case also, first time you make a misprediction. Okay. And subsequent predictions will be correct, provided that particular entry is not replaced from the BTP. So if you have enough capacity in the BTP, you should be able to hold this. Okay. Now, we talked about this indirect procedure calls, which are jump and link register instructions in MIPS. What do you think about this? How will they perform with the BTP? Indirect procedure calls. What are these, by the way? How do they actually combine? What kind of instruction do they produce? What does this instruction do actually? Jala? How is it different from a direct procedure call? Does anybody remember? What kind of program constructs would lead to a Jala? So you'll get this from function pointers. Okay, when you have, and the function pointer may resolve to any procedure pretty much in your program at runtime. Okay, so which means your targets are going to vary for these instructions; they are not constant. So the BTP is probably highly inaccurate in this case, depending on your program behavior. But of course, if you have a pattern of locality that is over a phase of a particular execution, you have particular function pointer results to the same function all the time, then the BTP is of course equivalent. Okay. Right? So there is no guarantee that we can give in this case for the BTP, like here. Okay. So that's about these three categories of branches, and then of course we have left out one major category, which is conditional branches. Okay. Where like your if else kind of constructs would lead to conditional branches, where depending on the condition outcome you take a branch, which is very different from these two. Loop branches are conditional branches, but they actually behave very regularly. Okay. It's not like if else type of branches, which may go either way. So for conditional branches, usually processors use a separate type of predictor, which are called direction predictors. Because here, all you want to know is which way am I going? Because I know the target. It's in the instruction actually. The offset is in the instruction, I just need to add the offset to the PC to get the target. All I need to know whether should I add that offset or not. That is, should I jump the target or should I just fall through? So it's a binary prediction. However, it's very dynamic in nature. The last target is not very helpful in general, because the last time the way you went, you may not go next time the same way. Okay. So maybe this time you take the if, execute the if part of a code, next time you might execute the else part, depending on the condition outcome. So you need a direction predictor, predicts taken or not taken, which is a binary prediction. Once that prediction is available, we can compute the target. And the question is, how does this coexist with the BTP? We'll talk about that very soon. One thing that we'll require to make good use of for direction predictor is that we need an ALU in the second state of the pipeline to compute the target. So this one was discussed last time somebody raised this issue that why can't you compute the target right here? Because part of the target is inside the instruction, it comes from the offset. So the point was that, well, I need an ALU here to be able to do that. We need an adder, essentially. Okay. So we'll assume the existence of an adder. So we'll see how that actually works very soon. So the last thing that is left is a type of instructions that return from a procedure. That's one type of control transfer instruction which is not covered in any of these types. So you end a procedure, you take a control transfer which returns you back to the calling site. And here also your BTP won't be very useful. Why is that? Can somebody guess? Or can somebody see? Why is a BTP not useful for return instructions?
Return address will be fine.
Why is that?
Because each time you call a subroutine, then you may be returning slightly different values.
No. This is not about return value. See, jump instructions are concerned about the next instruction to execute, right? The question is, what is my next place that I return to? It's not a return value that we're talking about. It has nothing to do with that. You understand what I'm saying? So I have a function f. I'm executing the function I call g here, okay? And this is my g. At some point, g will return, right? And when g returns, I'll have to start executing here. The question is, when I fetch this particular return instruction, do I know where to go next? That is the question. And that's not covered in any of these types. It's a very special type of instruction. And I'm saying that BTP is not going to be very helpful in this case. Why?
Might be calling from different
places. Exactly. So I might be calling G from many different places. So this time I call within F. Next time I might be calling G from H. So my return address will be all different actually every time. Of course, it may not be so in some cases, but anyway, it depends on your execution. Okay, so BTP is not going to be very helpful for this case. So what processors today include to tackle this matter is another hardware structure, which is called a return address stack. So it has nothing to do with your execution stack. Okay. It's a hardware structure which has a push-pop interface, and you can guess what it does. Whenever it fetches a JAL or JALR instruction, which are procedure calls, it would actually push the return address because it knows the return address at this time. When the JAL executes, the return address is just the PC plus 4, right? Or PC plus 8. Okay. And whenever you encounter a return instruction, it will just pop the stack. At the top of the stack should be your return address. So that's a prediction actually. That gives us a prediction, and in most cases, this will be very accurate. Okay. All right. So provided you don't overflow the RAS, because if you have a very deep call stack, you might overflow the RAS, in which case actually the predictions will go wrong at some point. So it's a hardware structure, it can overflow, so that can happen.
Okay. All right. So what's the size of it?
Depends. For example, the MIPS R10K had a 4-entry return address stack. So we can make it bigger. Bigger stacks probably would be better. So it depends on how much budget you have for hardware and all these things. But if you have a too smaller stack, then of course you have to live with mispredictions. At some point, you'll overflow and start giving out mispredicted values. Okay, so with all these things, so we have now the BTB, we have a direction predictor, we have a return address stack. The question is, what does my hardware look like that decides the next PC? Right? We have too many inputs now to be chosen from, right? So first, I'll assume that, first we make an observation that is in a five-stage MIPS with half-phase instruction fetch. A conditional branch prediction is of no use. Same is true about RAS. So let's try to understand why that is so. So let's go back to the structure. Yeah. So we are saying that we assume that we have a phased execution, just like MIPS R3K has. Okay. And we are saying that, well, of course, clearly the BTB is useful, right? We have already talked about that. Because we know that if we have a prediction of BTB here, we can use it here. Okay. If I do not have a delay slot filled in by the compiler. So now let's take up the branch, the direction prediction, for direction predictor for conditional branches. So the first question that we have to answer is, in which stage can I make a prediction? In which stage can I ask the direction predictor?
Instruction decode.
Right? So I cannot be asking the direction predictor before decode. Why is that?
We have to decode it first, then we know where the addresses. I mean,
so why is the address important? I just want to know yes or no. Address is not yet important. I just want to know whether I should go down the fall through or the target. That's all the predictor tells me. It doesn't tell me the target. I'll compute the target separately by using the offset, which I can do anytime. Remember that. Because I know that my last 16 bits are going to be offset. Okay. So I can just assume that everything is a branch. Even here, I can actually take those 16 bits and add it to PC plus 4. Maybe a garbage value if it's not a branch instruction. But I can do it here, actually. So all I'm asking is that the direction predictor will only tell me yes, no. It will not tell me the target. I'm asking where can I query that predictor? What is the earliest possible stage in the pipeline? Your answer is correct. I cannot do it before the decode stage, but why?
You need to evaluate the condition first.
Oh, condition evaluation will happen here. And if I evaluate the condition, why do I need a prediction then? Prediction is important only when I don't know what's going to happen, right? If I can evaluate tomorrow's temperature, why should I have a predictor for evaluating tomorrow's temperature? Yes?
After fetching the instruction, we will know that it's condition. Then only we should.
You will know what?
Whether it's conditional instruction or something else.
Right, exactly. So I need to know if it's a conditional branch or not. Okay, right? So that's the important point. And that I'll get to know only when I reach the decoder. I decode the branch, I decode the instruction, and I know that, oh, it's a conditional branch. Then only it makes sense to look up the branch predictor. Okay, alright? So I cannot, there is no hope of using the direction predictor in the fetch stage. Okay, alright? So I have to wait till the decoder, for sure. And if I have to wait till the decoder, then you can clearly see that there is no point in using this predictor. Because in the next cycle, anyway, I load the correct target, actually. Okay, all right? Is it clear to everybody? That in this particular setting, I don't need a direction predictor. Okay. What about the return address stack? Can I argue in the same way? right? Because I push or pop from the stack only after I know that I'm dealing with a procedure call or return. Otherwise, if I start popping the stack, I'll be actually popping wrong things. I mean, I'll be popping useful things at the wrong places actually. Okay, so I should be popping from the stack only if I know that it's a return instruction. Or I should be pushing on the stack only if I know that it's a procedure call. Right? Okay. All right, is it clear? Okay, all right. So for this particular pipeline, I'm only interested with dealing with the BTP. All right, so let's see how to do that. So if something is not clear, you can ask questions, okay, just remind you. So what does it mean? That means every cycle, the fetcher has to select from three options. One is PC+4 from the fetch decode register. So by the way, I'll be using this particular notation to denote the pipeline register sitting in the middle of, sitting in between fetch and decode stages. All right. So remember that every stage is, every two consecutive stages are separated by pipeline registers, right? So this is my IFID register. This is my IDX register. This is my X DMEM register and so on. Okay. I have the PC+4, which comes from this register, because remember that I had the PC, I have incremented it. Okay. And I am going to latch it in the IFID register in the next cycle. Okay. So from there I can take PC+4. I have the BTP output also from the IFID register. Okay. So the whatever output the BTP has given me. And the actual target, which is bypassed from the execution stage. Okay. This is available only for these three instructions, because these three instructions don't require any extra evaluation. I can evaluate the target from the instruction itself if I have a decoder, if I have an adder in the decoder. Okay. Because here the target is inside the instruction. Here the target comes from the register value. Okay. And here the target is also in the instruction. So under what condition do I have an input from the execution stage for the PC? If a branch instruction is currently executed there. Right? So which means two cycles earlier I fetched a branch, which is now resolvable. So I have an input coming from that stage telling me that, you know, you might have to change the PC if you made a misprediction. Okay, so let's assume that the BTP lookup returns a tuple, which is the first entry of the tuple is a hit miss indication, it's a binary value, and the second entry is the BTP contents. Okay, and on a miss, the second entry is going to be PC+4. All right, it tells me the fall through. That's not exactly coming from BTP, but I'll assume that that's how the tuple is generated from the BTP hardware. Okay. If last to last instruction was a control flow instruction, you compare BTP contents for that instruction with the actual target, right? So if the last to last instruction was a control flow instruction, you have to compare the BTP contents for that instruction with the actual target, right? Is that clear to everybody? On a mismatch, select actual target and zero out the IDX register, because the problem is that current instruction in the decoder is actually wrong, right? So you cannot put the contents of that into that IDX pipeline register. So what MIPS does is that it zeroes out that entire register. And the good thing is that the NOAP, the opcode of NOAP is actually all zero. So that will be actually interpreted as NOAP as it goes to the pipeline for it. So it doesn't do anything. And the IDX inputs are ANDed with a tilde of kill signal. So we'll look at, okay, here it is. So this is my program counter. And this is actually my pipeline register at the front of the fetch stage. So here I show this, you know, dotted line, it's actually the PC. Okay. At every clock, I latch a new PC, which will actually, you know, go to the memory, start fetch, and also do this addition and all. Okay. Alright? So that's why I show the clock directly fed to the program counter register. So what is happening? So in a particular clock cycle, I get a new PC. I feed to the adder, which adds 4 to that. So I get PC plus 4 here. Okay. And this PC is also sent to the memory for fetching the instruction, which will go into the instruction register, the fetch decode pipeline register. Okay. This PC is also sent to the BTB, the branch target buffer, for looking of the BTB. Okay. And what comes out from the BTB are two things. One is the BTB content, and other one is an indication of bit miss. Okay. All right. And the third thing that I get is a target from the execution stage. This is for an instruction which is currently executing in the execute stage. Okay. And this also comes accompanied with a kill signal. And this is enabled only if the currently executing instruction in the X pipeline stage is a control transfer instruction and its target does not match with the BTB outcome, which means I did something wrong in the past. Okay, so I have to kill some of the instructions inside the pipeline. So are the inputs okay before we look at this particular multiplexer which does the choice of the next PC? Is it okay? Alright. So what are my selections? So when do I pick the BTB contents? Well, when the kill is 0, all right, which means that everything is okay. And I have a hit in the BTB. So that is 0-0. Okay. All right. In that case, I'll pick the BTB content as my next PC. Okay. When do I pick PC plus 4? When kill is 0. And I miss in the BTB. When the selection is 0-1. And if kill is 1, then that overrides everything else, which means I made a mistake in the past, I have to fix it now. Okay. So if kill is 1, the other bit is don't care, I choose the target as the next piece that is coming from the execution stage. Okay, so in the next clock, essentially this PC will be latched here, and I'll be on the right path from there on. Okay. Is this hardware clear? The PC selection? Okay, so I essentially need a it's actually a 3-to-1 mux. These two are actually the same input. So the only thing that may happen now is that I have too many things on my critical path. I have a BTB in my critical path, I have a multiplexer on my critical path, which may actually lengthen my fetch cycle.
So what about the instruction in between that prediction?
Yeah, right, coming to that, yes.
We have to clutch them, right?
Yeah, so that's exactly what is mentioned here. The IDX inputs are ANDed with tilde kill. So tilde is not kill. Okay. So if kill is 1, that means you'll be feeding 0 in this particular register. Okay. So if you go back to this diagram, the wrong instruction is currently here, currently being decoded, right? Because I fetched an instruction, I made a prediction, which came here, all right? So I used a prediction to fetch a new instruction. And that instruction went into the here. And when the branch executes, the wrongly fetched instruction is here, right? In the decode stage. So this is where my time goes. So let's suppose this is my branch instruction. All right? This is, let's call it I0, that fetches here. And that was fetched using the BTB outcome coming from here. All right? Okay. And then I have some I1, which is fetched here. So that's a phased execution. This is going to be correct all the time because I'll get the target from here. Okay. So what we're talking about is how to select the PC at this particular stage. Okay. I have three inputs. One is this target. Okay. One is coming from here, which is PC plus 4, the next instruction of this. Okay. All right? And one is that I use this PC to look up the BTB, and the BTB told me something. There are three things. Okay, all right. Now the point is that if I made a wrong prediction for this branch when I looked up the BTB, that wrong instruction now, where is it currently? This is currently in the decode stage, right? Okay. When the branch is currently executing, that wrong instruction is here. So what I have to do is that when the contents of this decode stage will be fed into this register pipe, that has to be killed here. It should not be feeding these contents here because these are wrong. So what I'm doing is that I am ending all the IDX inputs with not kill. Okay, so IDX pipe, so IDX pipe register is sitting here. Okay, right. So if kill is zero, then whatever you have computed will go in that register. Otherwise, only zeros will go in that register.
Okay,
all right. Is the timeline clear to everybody? What's happening when?
I1 is also because of that I0, right? I1, IF.
No, I1 is always correct because we have a phased execution. I1 will get the correct
answer. That can be because of branch prediction or that PC+4 also. That can be because of that.
No. I1, so in this diagram, I'm actually selecting I1's PC. That's exactly what is being done here. Should I pick, so PC+4 is coming from here, this instruction. Okay. This instruction has also looked at the BTB. The BTB outcome is coming from there. And I have a target coming from here. Which of these three should I pick? That's what I'm asking. So I1 will actually proceed with the correct PC. And remember that it has to happen every cycle. This will be a continuous process. Every cycle you will be running this hardware. You should pick up one of these three things. Okay. Of course, in many cases, your your target will not even be a legitimate thing because there may not be a branch instruction executing now in X stage. Which is fine because in those cases, the kill will be zero for sure. Okay. Nothing to kill actually. So in that case, you'll be selecting one of these two, depending on whether you hit or miss in the blade. Is this clear? So how do I generate the kill signal? So this is a logic for kill. It takes is control instruction, so that's computed by the decoder, which is currently sitting in the decode execution pipeline register. Okay. It tells me whether the instruction currently executing in the execution stage is a branch or not. Right. Okay. And I end that with this particular clause which says next PC IDX is not equal to target. So notice that next PC gets the PC whatever I calculated. If there is a mismatch with this and the current instruction is a control instruction, I should kill. Okay. I enable kill at that. And NPC is carried till IDX register because beyond that point this is not required anymore. Okay. And is control instruction is generated by the decoder. So this particular variable will be high whenever the decoder comes across any control transfer instruction. Is this clear? If it is not clear, you're going to have a hard time in the next slide. Because we're going to introduce a direction predictor. There will be a fourth outcome. There will be a fourth input in this number, actually. So ask now, if it is not clear. So now, let's assume that either the branch target cannot be made ready in half cycle, or instruction fetch cannot be accommodated in half cycle. So what does that mean? That means I have genuinely two bubbles that I have to nullify. Right? So now the pipe timeline looks like this. So this is my branch instruction. I will know the target only here. Okay. So you have to fix up something here in these two cycles. And now actually a direction predictor makes very much sense because I can make a prediction here which I can use in this cycle to override the BTB prediction. Okay, all right? So a direction predictor and a return address stack is helpful provided instruction decoding followed by prediction can be completed in a cycle. So now you have to make sure that you decode the instruction, look up the predictor, and this whole thing can be completed in a single cycle. Otherwise, of course, there is no use. You have to complete decoding and prediction in this one cycle. Okay, all right? And they have to go serially. They cannot go concurrently. You first decode, and then look up the predictor. You first decode, then you will pop or push from the NAS. Okay? And we assume that the direction predictor or RAS can offer a better prediction than BTB, and hence will override the BTB prediction. So we'll always do that. Okay, so in some cases, of course, it may be opposite, that the BTB may actually give you a better quality prediction. That's possible. But in this particular discussion, we are going to override the BTB prediction with whatever the direction predictor tells you or the RAS tells you. And now the fetcher has another option, namely the predicted target from the decode stage. Now the decode stage is now going to give you another input into the fetcher, which is the outcome coming from the RAS or the direction predictor. And now I'll generate one more signal, that is BTB kill. Okay, so let's try to understand what's really happening. So here I use this PC to look up the BTB. Okay, the BTB will tell me something, all right, which I'm going to use here, all right? And in this cycle, I may figure out that I get a prediction from here, from the direction predictor. So I have to override this one. Okay. So that is this signal, which kills the instruction fetched according to the BTB's outcome, all right? And finally, when the instruction executes, I may get another indication saying that, oh, you made a mistake here also. Then I'll have to generate a kill signal. Okay, so I'll have two kill signals now. One is the BTB kill, another is the traditional kill that we had last time. So let's see what it looks like. I'll have a bigger marks for sure. So I have my PC as usual. I compute PC plus 4. I look up the BTB. BTB gives me some contents. And now to my multiplexer, I have what are the inputs? I have the BTB contents. I have PC plus 4. I have a predicted PC coming from the decoder, and I have a target coming from the execution stage. All right, okay. And what I'll assume here is that whatever is coming in as predicted PC can be either from the direction predictor or from the return address stack. All right. I'll not open up this particular thing here. Okay. So now what is the logic? You can easily figure out. So when do I pick my BTB contents? When kill is zero, when BTB kill is zero, and I miss, and I hit in the BTB. Right? In that case, I pick up the BTB contents. When do I pick up PC plus 4? When kill is zero, when BTB kill is zero, and I miss in the BTB. All right? When do I pick up the predicted PC? So the predicted PC is picked up when kill is zero. All right? And I have a BTB kill signal coming in, and I don't really care what's next. And where do I pick the target? When the kill is 1. Everything else is gone. Because kill is the golden rule. It tells me that, oh, here is the correct target. You should go along this direction. Everything else here is a prediction. But this is always correct. Right? Okay. So whenever kill is on, I have to ignore everything else. I have to pick up this target and set the PC to that one, to the next side. Is it clear? All right? So what is predicted PC coming from the decode stage? So let's assume the existence of an address adder in the decoder. So we have four options here in the decoder. What are the options? If instruction is conditional branch, you look up direction predictor and compute pred PC based on that. The direction predictor will tell you either take false loop or go to the target. Okay. So whatever it tells me to do, I'll set predicted PC to that. Okay. All right. If the instruction is a return statement, that is JR, you pop from the return address stack and use that as pred PC. Okay? If instruction is a jump and link or jump, so these are direct procedure calls and unconditional jumps, compute pred PC based on target field from IR. So by the way, although I call it pred PC, this is going to be correct all the time. Okay. This is actually correct. There is no prediction going on here. Okay? And in all other cases, pred PC is NPC IFID, whatever is carried forward from the fetch stage. Okay, alright, so remember that. What is NPC? So NPC is this one. Whatever PC I'm using to fetch, I carry it forward. Alright. So essentially what I'm saying is that in the decode stage, if this is not a control transfer instruction, my pred PC is just the PC that I carry with me. Alright. So which means even in the decoder, pred PC will be selected by a multiplexer. I have a multiplexer which I am not showing in the decode stage. Going to push on the RAS. So you push on the RAS when you encounter a procedure call instruction in the decode stage after the instruction is decoded. And you may have to repair the RAS if kill is enabled. Can somebody explain what this is actually? Kill is enabled when I made a misprediction, which means I fetched at least two instructions. Well, I fetched two instructions along the wrong path, exactly two instructions. Then I got a kill signal telling me that these two instructions are wrong, you should redirect yourself along the right path. Why do I have to repair the NAS in that case?
We might need to pop out something from NAS.
Why is that?
If we have pushed something, some wrong address into NAS.
And how can that happen?
Maybe some kind of function call is there and we have pushed that.
Which one is the function call here? You're right. Just tell me which one of these is a function call. Why should I push something on the NAS? Only when I see a function call.
Yeah.
And when do I see a function call? Here. Suppose this branch is mispredicted. So I get a kill signal here. Finally, when I try to fetch.
Execution, at the time of execution later.
Sorry?
At the time of execution, we have to...
Well, I push on the RAS in the decode stage, I said. So, when I get the kill signal here, why do I have to repair the RAS? What might have corrupted the RAS? Yes?
New instructions which we have just fetched, they might have done some entering.
Exactly. So, if one of these is a function call, you might have pushed something on the RAS which is wrong. You shouldn't have pushed actually. Okay. What if one of these is a return instruction? You have popped something out of the RAS. That's a major headache actually. There is no way to repair it now. You have popped something out. So I'm not going to detail of this. There are ways. Can somebody guess what might be a way to fix this?
Don't do RAS operation.
Well, then, I mean, what's the point, right? I have to push or pop, right? Is it clear? If I have a return instruction, it's a nightmare now. There's no way to get the RAS back to the correct state. So what can you do? How to fix it?
Secondary
RAS, right? You can copy the RAS, exactly. So one possibility is that, so we'll probably encounter this particular idea over and over as we go forward and do all these predictions. This is called checkpointing. So before you pop the RAS, you can checkpoint the RAS. Okay. So you can copy the RAS entries somewhere so that whenever you see a kill signal, you copy the RAS entries back. So you're in the right state. Right? So it gradually gets complicated. We'll see why. Okay. Now we're just dealing with maybe one or two bad instructions. As the pipe gets longer and longer, you may make too many wrong predictions. And too many wrong things may need to get into the pop, too many onto the RAS, and too many pops may happen out of the RAS. The question is, how many checkpoints can I make? So there are many issues coming up. So anyway, so this is a difficult problem. Yes?
Sir, here only the second instruction can corrupt the RAS.
This one cannot. You're right, yes. Yes, because this one only get a chance to go to decode. This one will get killed even before that. Yes, that's right. Yeah. Okay, how to compute BTB kill and kill? So BTB kill is control instruction and pred PC not equal to FPC, right? So whatever you have predicted, the decode state doesn't match with whatever PC I carried forward from the fetch stage. Okay, so that means I made a mistake in the BTB. And kill is same as before. Is control instruction and pred PC not equal to target. So the last time we had NPC, now NPC will be changed to pred PC because the pred PC is the one that overrides NPC now. And that's what is carried forward. Okay. So note that pred PC gets fed into the IDX register in place of NPC. Okay, alright. Is it clear? This particular hardware? So this is a very generic hardware now. We have incorporate pretty much every possible prediction that you can do related to control transfer instructions. Okay. So this is very generic. This is what is found in the feature of every modern processor. Only thing is that as your pipeline gets longer, you may have to kill more instructions. However, this particular selection of PC hardware is more or less same. And when to put something in the BTB, we have already discussed this actually. Put taken control instructions after real target is known, and it includes all control transfer instructions, conditional, unconditional jumps, procedure calls, procedure returns, and taken conditional branches. All control transfer instructions will go into BTB, even though you have a separate RAS for handling these instructions. Okay. Because BTB is providing you an early prediction for everything pretty much. On a miss replace an entry, you can have a replacement policy like LRU or anything. On a hit, update the entry. So we've talked about these things. So possible optimizations. You can optimize the BTB to store one or more target instructions instead of actual PC. So instead of storing the target PC, you can actually store the instruction itself so that you can nullify one fetch operation. So is it clear to everybody what I'm talking about here? So currently BTB stores the program counter, and you have to take the program counter and fetch the instruction. Instead of saying, don't even fetch, put the instruction itself in the BTB. Okay, so for unconditional branches, this is called branch folding. Essentially, you're nullifying one instruction there. Okay. Feature optimizations, you could explore both branch paths simultaneously for conditional branches. So do you see any problem with this? So I'm saying that, well, I don't really have a predictor, so I'll go along both the paths and start fetching from both the sides. And eventually, I'll figure out which one is correct. So I've nullified one of the paths. Okay. So what is the problem with this? So no processor actually does it. So there must be some feature issue here. What is that? Well, they will actually try to modify what? Okay. No, but okay. So let's assume for now that whatever you compute, you don't store them actually in persistent memory. Let's suppose that we have some hidden buffers where you can buffer the results. So we'll get to that point later. So that's not a problem. Let's assume for now. Is there any other issue? So what she has pointed out is very interesting. She's saying that, well, we are fetching these wrong instructions. What if they actually modify some registers or anything, right? So till now, the problem is not there because these instructions don't execute. Even before executing, they get killed. So we'll get to that point very soon. Okay. What is the problem here? Exploring both the paths simultaneously. Yes.
You always need extra hardware.
Yes, exactly. So we're just wasting resources here, right, by doing this. So essentially, half of our instructions will be killed anyway. So why do that? Rather have a predictor which will give you more than 50% probability of being correct. Because here essentially I'm assuming that I'm correct with probability half. That's all I'm saying. Because I know that other half will get killed. But your predictors may be smarter, and they can give you very high accuracy, much more than 0.5 probability of being correct. Okay. You can pre-decode instructions for predictor access in the future, because we have a problem here that we cannot access the direction predictor until we decode the instruction. So what I'm saying is that you could have a single bit in your instruction which says, oh, this is a conditional branch. So the fetcher can immediately look up that bit and can access the predictor right in the fetch stage. Okay. So then you have a much better prediction to start with, actually. You don't have to rely on the BTB, which tells you what happened last time. Okay. And there is something called a trace cache. So we'll talk about that more later. It's essentially, roughly speaking, it's a cache which stores the dynamic sequence of instructions that were encountered last time you executed along this path. So essentially what happens is that if you are executing this particular function f, you would actually store instructions in this sequence instead of storing f somewhere and g somewhere. Okay. You'll actually store it like this. So you'll store the trace that you executed. So next time, when you look up the trace cache, you know which way to go. But again, the problem is that it tells you what happened last time. So traces may change depending on your control paths. So of course, there are ways to circumvent that problem, and we'll talk about that later in the trace cache. Okay, so before I go to direction predictor, which probably I'm going to start today, or maybe I can just introduce that, any problem or any question with this till now? So we haven't yet opened up the direction predictor model. We have said that there is something sitting there, a black box, which gives you a yes no answer. You ask, tell me what to do with this conditional branch, which either says taken or says false. So there has to be something going on inside, right? We'll open that up now, but before that, any question?
Second optimization method.
Yeah. Which one? Second one. Yeah, so what here I'm saying is that, see, here we could not access the direction predictor until we decode the instruction, right? Because I know that at this point only, I know that it's a conditional branch. I'm saying that suppose you pre-decode the instruction and you put a single bit in the instruction which tells me if it's a conditional branch or not. Okay, so the fetcher can look up that bit and can access the predictor right here.
BTB optimization, even if we save instruction BTB, we have to spend entire cycle in instruction fetch. What do we achieve? I mean, the cycle time will be...
Oh, no, no, no. You save one instruction, right? So let's see what's happening. So you have an unconditional jump instruction, right? Okay. So traditionally, what would have happened? This instruction would go through the pipeline, right? In this state, it gets fetched. In this state, it actually computes the target, or maybe here, depending on where you have your address adder. And then it will have nothing to do with these two states, okay, right? Here, what will happen is that you look up the PC, you take the PC, look up the BTB. BTB tells you the target instruction, which would have got fetched here. But actually, it gets fetched here itself and gets in the decoder here. So you save a cycle. Any other question? So I'll just introduce the basic thing here. So people started with, so is the problem clear to everybody that I have a conditional branch and I want to build a function, right? The input to which is this particular branch instruction and the outcome is a binary, 0 or 1. Okay, so it's taken or false. Okay. So to begin with, people looked at static prediction. Okay, that is, you take a conditional branch and you say you predict always not taken or always taken. So what is the penalty associated with it? Depends, right, with the branch behavior. You may be, if you say always not taken, maybe you're always correct. That depends on the branch, right? Okay. However, the point is that this is very simple and this can be actually done at compile time. So you can. So always not taken. So for example, if you take an unconditional, sorry, if you take a conditional branch, the loop conditional branch, right? And if you predict always not taken, you'll be wrong most of the time. Because the loop ending branches are actually taken most of the time. It's not taken only once, last time. And so once people made this observation that loop branches are, you know, special types, so they said, well, let's improve the static prediction. We'll say forward not taken and backward taken. Okay. So whenever you have a forward branch, that is, here is a branch instruction and its target is actually in front of it, okay, then I'll say that it's not taken. But the target is before it, then I'll say taken. So essentially what happens is that the loop branches will fall in this category. These are backward branches. And I'll say always taken for those branches. So now I'm correct except the last time. Right? And usually people would use forward not taken for if-else type of branches, where your target is actually forward in front of you, right? So essentially you have an if condition, and then you have else, right? So these branches, target will be this one, actually. It's a forward branch. And so you say forward not taken means that you are actually saying that for if-else type of constructs, the if part will be executed most often. Right? And actually turns out to be true. That's very interesting. So it may be because the way we think is that we put the true part first before we put the false part. Right? So it turns out that forward not taken, backward taken is a very good predictor actually in most cases. Now what happened is that this was pretty good actually, but of course you can improve upon that if you observe the dynamic behavior of branches. So just to give you the problem, give you some idea about the problem, assume that you have a pretty deep pipeline, okay, not like a five-stage pipeline, you have more stages actually. So we talked about branch penalty, right, at some point. So branch penalty is essentially the number of cycles that you lose because of a wrong prediction. So it's essentially the time from when the branch is fetched to the time the branch executes.
Okay.
So however many cycles you have in between is the maximum branch penalty that you pay. So here's an example. Suppose a processor, MIPS R4000, takes 3 pipe stages to compute the target and evaluate the condition after fetch.
Okay.
So after fetch, you have 3 more pipe stages before you get to the execute stage, as opposed to 1 here.
Okay.
Assume 4% unconditional jump, 6% not taken conditional branch, 10% taken conditional branch. Evaluate the CPI increase for 3 schemes. Unconditional flush, predicted always taken, predicted always not taken. So I'll talk about this problem next time, maybe. Because we don't have time. So we'll see what exactly the issue is when we evaluate these three CPIs. Okay, so we'll start from here.